Hey guys, TechoSword here. So today we have something a bit different from my lately BIOS and performance comparison content. Instead, in this video, I'm going ahead and try on two heatsinks that I got for the Region Go SSD while also comparing thermal performance in order to understand the actual difference it makes, to help you decide whether it's worth choosing to apply a heatsink or not. So first up, we have this low profile copper heatsink, and we have seen it being applied to both Steam Deck and the ROG Ally, and it quite helped reducing thermals. Keep in mind that this one instead is specifically made for the Region Go NVMe 2242 form factor. What's great about this one is that it also comes with a full kit including mounting screws and two thermal pads, with the pink one being 0.5mm in thickness, while the grey one is 1mm. In case you have a limited clearance, they included two pad choices, but I think in our case a 1mm pad will be just fine. So now let's set this one aside for a moment, because I want to show you the second one that is quite different. So it's made by Final Cool in aluminum, and as you can see, it's significantly bulkier. Here it says dimensions are 37mm in length, 24mm in width, and 11mm in height. And it's also specifically made for 2242 form factor. I think it's a bit of a gamble whether it's going to fit in the Region Go, but definitely worth a try. So let's check it out. It also comes with the thermal pads and mounting screws. So now that we finished with the unboxing, let's head over to the installation process of the low profile heatsink. So starting by removing first the 6 screws of the back cover. There will need something like a guitar pick or a pry tool to take the cover off. Thankfully though, the heatsink kit also includes a pry tool, but I personally prefer using this one by iFixit. It's very slim and could easily slip into the edges. I honestly found it much easier after trying both. But anyway, just slide it in across the edges and gently lift off the cover once it's loose. Now the next step will be to take off the graphite sheet from the SSD. And always disconnect the battery cable before to ensure a safe and smooth upgrade. Here I'm using a pry tool to remove the cable, since it's placed in a quite tight spot for fingers to hold it. So with the cable disconnected, we can now remove the SSD. So I'll stick the 1mm thermal pad to the SSD, and remember to peel off the protective film gently to make sure it's transferring heat efficiently. Next step will be obviously applying the heatsink on, and as you can see, it's perfectly tailored for this SSD size, covering the whole area. We can now reassemble everything and carefully putting the SSD back in place and reconnect all back on. I can confirm that with this heatsink, you can close the back cover easily without any issue. So clearance wise, it's perfectly fine. We'll come back on to do a performance comparison later on, but let's check the installation process of the aluminum heatsink we talked about earlier. So for that, I remove again the SSD and take off the heatsink we just applied. Also, the installation process of this heatsink is pretty straightforward. First, slide the SSD into the mounting base. And next, apply the thermal pad. Then place the heatsink while aligning it with the screw holes and just tighten them. Just by looking at it, you can already tell it's going to cool down the SSD by a lot. Now that it's all applied, let's install the SSD back on. And here you will notice there is an enough clearance for it to fit in both lengths and widths. However, the height of it is making it impossible to close the back cover now. So, I also tested other copper heatsinks I have, even with this one being a 7mm in height, for example, yet the back cover wouldn't close anymore. So guess we need something like 4 or even 2mm in height for it to fit. Which by the way, I already have them ordered from AliExpress, so once they arrive, I'll make sure to share it with you guys whether they can fit and show you the thermal results. So stay tuned for that. But for now, so far the only ones that didn't cause any issue was the slim copper one we just tried earlier. So let's hope it can deliver at least some decent thermal reduction, and for that we'll test it now to find out by how much. So here we're back in Windows. Let me briefly mention how I'll compare the SSD temperatures. With a full fan speed, I ran a CrystalDiskMark test, and usually this one pushes the drive to its maximum load. So the temperatures we're about to see might seem alarming, but remember this is an extreme test and like worst case scenario. After that, we'll run a 1 hour gameplay session in Cyberpunk in order to get a real world usage data. So that being said, let's start the CrystalDiskMark test now. Now that it's finished, let's review the maximum temperatures recorded. But before we dive into the numbers, let me clarify the meaning of the drive sensors. Drive temperature 1 measures the NAND flash media, and drive 2 typically shows the hottest spot of the NAND media, while drive 3 tracks the ISIC controller. So on the stock setup, the first sensor peaked at 82 degrees and the hotspot at a whopping 106 degrees. As for the ISIC controller, it hit 80 degrees. Instead, with the copper heatsink installed, we saw a significant improvement. 68 degrees for drive 1. As for the NAND flash media hotspot, it peaked at 90 degrees. And for controller, this time it hit 68. So that translates to a reduction of about 15 degrees across the board, and that's quite a substantial improvement. I also checked the skin temperature of the Legion Go with the heatsink applied. It's clear that the surrounding area is cooler as well, making it a win-win situation. So now let's move on to the Cyberpunk 1 hour gameplay test. So after an 1 hour of gameplay, the stock configuration still showed high temperatures. For instance, 74 degrees for drive temperature 1 and 98 degrees for the hotspot. In contrast, with the heatsink applied, we got 70 degrees for drive temperature 1 and 90 degrees for the hotspot. So despite the heatsink managing to lower temps by about 15% than stock, with a full fan speed, you could hit 90 degrees on the NAND hotspot, which still doesn't seem too ideal. Generally speaking, it's best to keep the SSD temp in the 50s for the first drive sensor and around the 70s for the NAND flash media hotspot. So overall, I highly recommend installing a heatsink for your Legion Go SSD. For a start, I would recommend this low profile copper heatsink. Later on, if I find a better cooling efficient one that could fit right, I will share about it with you guys here while comparing temp results. So at the end, I really hope you found this video informative and helpful. Please subscribe to TechoSol to be up to date with the upcoming stuff. I have lots of exciting things lined up and would love to have you aboard. As always, thanks for watching and see you in the next one.